Today we're talking about film festival.
That adds color to the story.
Welcome to this episode of Butter City, all about filmmaking with a little bit of a Minnesota twist. Today we're talking about film festivals, and specifically the Twin Cities Film Festival. We have board member Bill Cooper, as well as the executive director, Jatin Setia. Welcome, guys.
Hey, thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Thanks for being on the show.
Absolutely.
So let's go back to the conception, you know, of the Twin Cities Film Festival. Where was the first spark of, when was the twinkle in the eye of the creator?
The twinkle in my eye was approximately 4 years ago. And at that point, I'd been laid off of my corporate job, which was fine. Did that corporate life for about 10 years or so. But I've always had a passion for acting and just the film industry. So I started doing some acting work around town, short films here and there, doing some 40-hour film festival stuff. And that's where kind of the spark came in. I can truly say that one night I was literally sleeping and I woke up in the middle of the night and I said, I think we need a major mainstream festival here in town that caters to the general audience. So I started doing my research and I went to other film festivals in town here. They're all amazing. They all cater to certain niches, which is amazing as well. I did some national research. I went to a Tribeca Festival, LA Festival, Chicago, kind of got that vibe and kind of brought it back home. And I said, this is what we need here. And then, Bill and I were on a set together. Like I said, I was an actor. Mm-hmm. And Bill and I got to talking, and I told him a little secret.
What's the secret, Bill?
Well, he cornered me, and he said, I have a secret. I have an idea, and I'll tell you it if you don't tell anybody until we kind of know what's going on. Because, again, there are a lot of great festivals in town and different things, and we wanted to make sure we had our ducks in order before we sort of made it public. But he told me about it, and I was immediately latched onto the idea for a couple of reasons. Number one, there's a great film community here. There is no doubt about that. The idea that we have a strong acting community, strong producing and directing, television shows, all those kind of things as well. But also part of a good film community is also a technical place where you can rent things, cinequip, and one of those things, but also a great exhibition community. And so as we talked more about it, I thought this is a terrific idea. And I also have to say just a couple of kudos to Jatin as well, is one of the things that really got me interested was because Jaden's not only an actor and a film lover, but he comes from a business background. And so as we look at doing a film festival, we also think of it as, even though we're a nonprofit organization, we are in it to make money so we can improve from year to year and offer a better overall experience to everybody that attends, whether you're a filmmaker or a film goer. So after he told me that secret, I would have to say I've been on board 150% for the last 3-4 years.
Absolutely.
So, I mean, it is kind of interesting. You know, like people sometimes think that filmmaking is just, it's an art form and it just needs to mm-hmm. be art. And then you do need that for sustainability. You do need that mindset of like, it is about creating a business plan. And mm-hmm. it is about, it doesn't matter if you make a great film if nobody sees it. So how do you build up that audience? Is that one of the intentions behind this festival, is to kind of build an audience, you know, in Minnesota that can watch these films, these great films that you guys are bringing in, but as well, it's probably going to feed and carry over to watching some of the films that are coming out of Minnesota as well.
Absolutely. And I'll defer to Bill on this.
I mean, sure. As I said before, you know, exhibition is part of a total film community. So it's important then to have those kinds of experiences available for people. And I would say this, I mean, the basic form of business is not to do something that's already been done. And again, as we mentioned, there are other really terrific niche film festivals, international film festival that's been around for many, many years. But when we took a look at what could we do that's different, we took a look at the mainstream audience. We don't go after tons of international films. We really have because we've been involved as filmmakers here in Minnesota, we have a huge commitment to Minnesota films and filmmaking. We usually have sidebars. For instance, this year we're looking at women, and we also have a sidebar, I think I can say it, Indian films. So that, again, our idea is to have good quality films that everybody enjoys and potentially films that people won't necessarily see in the theaters. The last point I want to make really quickly, and just a shout out to Allied Marketing, who's helped us with our bigger films that we're getting. Those films are sort of in part of the film festival circuit because they're going to be released to the general public theatrically this fall or early in the winter, so therefore they like to look at festivals. Your studio films like to look at festivals right before it's going to be released so you can create buzz and all of that. So we're excited about bringing in studio films so that we can bring in some notable actors and directors and all of that. Even in our first year in it, we had 19 directors here and had 35 films, so we're feeling good about it.
Well, I remember in the first year you guys had Waiting for Superman, and it was a great turnout. Mm-hmm. I mean, huge shows, and then it was a great dialogue with the community as well. But it was nice because what I think you're able to do is you're bringing in somebody who wants to see a mainstream film, and at the same time while they're there, they're going to flip through the program and they're going to be like, hey, I want to check out this. So they get exposure to some other things as well, and it's like kind of this cross-pollination.
And that's the idea the general public comes into play. We want to introduce a new audience to, like you said, filmmaking as art. But the way you get some of these audiences in is by those hook of those studio films. There are great films out there, even studio films, Waiting for Superman, obviously, Fair Game, which was our closing night film with Bill Pollat attended and introduced the film. I mean, all of our films last year that were studio films were based on true stories. It just happened that way, but those are the cornerstone that bring the general audiences in, and then actually has some great feedback saying, hey, because I came to this, conviction or secretariat, I actually went to this Minnesota film as well. It was good. And that's the best thing I can hear as I'm putting together a program is an individual coming to see a film, but they hang around and potentially go watch another film. Hence, exposing them, and again, next year, they come back and do it again.
Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say also, I think all of us involved in the festival, and there are so many other people that love film, we want to keep this film experience alive. The idea of going to there are big screens in everybody's houses, and people are watching stuff on Netflix, which I do, yep. But there's just that experience of going into a theater, the lights go down, and something happens. And I would also expand that having a film festival, it also is not just a film, it really becomes an event. When we bring in, for instance, when we bring in directors and actors and things, we put them on panels. We have conversations with them. We have opportunities for them to get involved in the local media and stuff. So instead of just that Friday night, Saturday night sort of thing where you go in and you go out, you come and maybe hang out a while because you have an opportunity to interact. And it's an event. It's a complete event. Music events. Just a lot of stuff happens.
Right. So that's how a difference between you going to a Friday night film than going to a Friday night film festival film is you'll get to see the actors there. Mm-hmm. You'll get to interact with the director or the producer or the writer. You maybe even be able to go to a panel discussion and actually have an in-depth conversation about the art of filmmaking, the art of producing, or the art of cinematography. And that's where a festival is an event, like Bill mentioned. And that's the vibe that we're creating. And this year's festival is obviously at the Icon Theaters, which are just the most amazing, gorgeous, absolutely, yeah. Gorgeous theaters. And we're just so honored to be there in the West End property. And that was one of the feedbacks that we got last year was, move it to a more confined space. I mean, downtown Minneapolis was amazing to us. We have great vendor relationships there. But it was still kind of, you go to an after event here, but then you have to walk 10 blocks to go to another party. The West End remedies that for us, free parking and plenty of it for that matter, with their great restaurants like Crave and Sopranos. So you have your events right there on that spot. And again, we're creating this environment of an event.
Well, I mean, I think you guys do a very good job of it because I know it was at the last film festival, and it is an event. But what's at the heart of it still is the storytelling. Yeah. And so let's take a look at some of the clip from one of these stories.
Sure. Thank you. Good.
Can you suspend disbelief for a minute?
You know when you feel a presence? They say it's like the hair on the back of your neck standing up, where the temperature in the room drops a few degrees, like a cold spot. Or maybe what they're sensing is just a shift in the electromagnetic energy levels. If the bottleneck between the other side and ours is just a shortage of ambient energy, Let's see what happens if we give it to them.
I saw somebody I haven't seen in quite some time.
There's people in your house. They've been dead 20 years? That's not possible, right?
Maybe some people aren't supposed to come back.
You are messing with ideas that you know nothing about.
It was your machine that brought her back!
Are you coming to bed?
You're not supposed to be here.
Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are.
This is it's a great clip, because what this film, Ghost from the Machine, is really a highlight of kind of the work that you guys have been doing, and the cross-pollination and the help that can happen for Minnesota filmmaking. And I wanted to welcome Bobby Marsden, who's going to be doing the Minnesota programming for the mm-hmm. festival. And can you talk a little bit about a clip like this that was in the first year of the festival, how this festival can help films like this kind of get seen?
Sure. Well, I think, you know, the festival can help any film get seen for that matter, whether it's Minnesota or domestic, international. I think one of the great things about this festival being located in Minnesota and having a Minnesota premiere is that most of the time, a lot of the work was done by Minnesotans. And they don't always get a theatrical premiere. Sometimes it's, you know, the director invites everybody over to his living room and he's got a fairly big TV and everybody crowds around on a couch. But then you're seeing it with people that you worked on the film with, and that's kind of a biased opinion. And so I think what filmmakers usually walk away with as their best experience is they had an unbiased audience mm-hmm. see that film and they got real feedback. And in the case of that film, it was sold out and people loved it. And back then it was called Phasma Ex Machina. Now it's changed its name because it's got distribution. Mm-hmm. And I heard things are going really great, yeah.
Absolutely.
So what is it that, you know, in the design of the festival, what is it that you're looking for specifically when you're going to pick something that's from Minnesota? Like, how are you selecting that to fit with these other films that you're bringing in?
Well, I think, first and foremost, it's the quality of the story. You don't need $500,000 to tell a great story. You need a great story. Mm-hmm. Then, you know, there's other elements that come in about, you know, execution and production quality and things like that, and that's definitely something that we try and look at. But first and foremost, it's always about the story. And then, as you alluded to, there's other programmers, there's other films coming in, and we want to make sure that, you know, the films coming in have some kind of a synergy, some kind of a place, because as a whole, the festival begins on opening day and closes on closing night. And I think you want to flow.
Right.
You don't want hiccups, because then things stand out, and maybe for the wrong reason.
Mm-hmm. We have over 200 submissions just this year. And to whittle those down to the 35 to 40 that we're going to show, excluding the shorts that have been coming in, and to echo what Bobby said, you have to find that synergy. So majority of our work is watching these films, but also keeping in mind every single other film that has mm-hmm. come through and say, what makes sense here? What do we want to project out to our audiences this year? Last year was spirituality with the Minnesota programming, with Man-Made, as well as Nature of Existence alongside Phasma. This year is yet to be, I mean, it's one of those things that at the beginning of each of these programming, it's almost like you're pulling at your hair. I'm like, where is this going to go? But eventually it falls into place.
Yeah.
And we have a great lineup this year, and we couldn't be more proud of it. So.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, Jane, when you, it's like you got into this because you had this dream that you're gonna create the mainstream Twin Cities Film Festival. But what has your vision of films like changed with this experience? Because I mean, you're getting a lot more detail about them than you probably would have ever gotten before.
Absolutely. Every day is a learning process, and I have gotten to not just love films, but live films. I dream about the festival. My wife doesn't like that too much, but it's changed me for the better, definitely. I know that this is the line of work that I want to be in. I know that it's a nonprofit organization, so it means so much more to me. And to have the core team that I have around my around me with Bill Cooper and Bobby and Steve Snyder, who's a lead programmer, these individuals only enhance my love for filmmaking because they all have individual passions about filmmaking. It's finding that synergy between what's a good film. I never like rejecting films. I don't. I hate it. I'm like, they put so much work into that.
Sometimes they don't. It's okay.
They put so much work into that. But as a director, I do have to realize, like, I want to echo what Bill Cooper mentioned earlier as far as having this be run as a for-profit entity in making money, and everything runs off the almighty dollar. So all we're doing is trying to put together a really nice event. We stretch our dollar to the max. You have no idea. And that's the beauty of the fact that we can put something like that together every year. We're getting such great praise from media and all the studios, which are hard to get. Mm-hmm. You know, now that you're getting studios to send us films, that's amazing. Mm-hmm. With actors,
and it's even better. Hard to get Minnesota films. I mean,
Absolutely.
There's a lot of great films coming out of Minnesota, and they have big dreams, mm-hmm. as they should. You know, and we love to be in a position to help catapult that. But that doesn't mean that they see screening in Minnesota first as that best opportunity, you know, and they have to take into account all the different options and cities and distribution companies. And, you know, there's a film right now being it's in post and it's almost finished, but there's four distribution companies fighting over it right now, which means I can't get it. Okay. And as a programmer, you know, it makes you happy to know that those kind of films are coming out of Minnesota, but it's like, why can't they figure that out? Because I want to put it in my festival. But
exactly. Well, I wanted to ask you, Bobby, you know, you're kind of a veteran programmer in a sense. I mean, you've worked with a lot of film festivals in the area. And what are the nuts and bolts that are true across the board for film festivals that you know has to go in that people might not be aware of?
It's a great question. I'll kind of echo what I said before. I mean, it's always about the quality of story. I mean, the first and foremost thing that you have to take into account is your writing. You can't shoot a film without a script. Even if it's a documentary, you need a solid idea. And I would say take the time to write that, to let people critique it, you know, take it to workshops. There's a great workshop here called Docu Club. I think that's still happening, and that's with IFP. So there's a lot of different opportunities. You can go to the Screenwriters Guild. I mean, there's a million different places you can take your script, and once you get that to a point where you're ready to shoot it, then you need to invest all your time and effort and money and favors and having your friends help you and going to your great uncle and saying, I was wondering if I could borrow $10, but you know, that takes a lot of time and effort. That could take years, and then that takes you to the point where you're ready to screen it. And I think what I've seen is that the eagerness can sometimes get in the way of making the right decision, and it's great to be eager and to have that anxiousness and be excited to make your film, but take your time. Because the festivals are, we're gonna be here for a long time and we're always ready to take your film, but we want you to give us the best product. So that's the first thing, is make your story strong.
We get feedbacks too. You know, yeah. when a filmmaker wants to screen their film, it's a responsibility of Bobby's to look at the film and say, if you work on it a little bit more, that's what he's here for. He makes the filmmakers better. I think that's what you do. That's one of the reasons that I love working with him. Because he gives honest feedback because he's done this for years. So he doesn't want to have that pressure on, I need to screen it now. Wait. We're not the only festival. You can screen it other places as well. We just want to make sure you have the best experience out of it.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and I come from a production background. I work in advertising and marketing. I make commercials and, you know, those are little small snippets, but if you can imagine the huge budgets that go in to make a 30-second spot, you know, not every filmmaker has that kind of money at their disposal, and they're trying to make an hour-and-a-half piece.
Yeah.
So they're stretching the dollar even more than we are, I think. And, you know, so take your time. Make the best story you can. But there's some logistical things. Like, if you're making a short film, try and keep it short. From a programming perspective, you know, when we put a program together, at least how I try to look at it, is I want to put a strong collection of films together, 10 to 12 films that I can screen. If you make a 30 or 40 minute film, I only have an hour and a half really to put my program together. So
let's not to interrupt you, but I want to take this moment and take a look at one of the films that you have screening in the festival.
You can do what you're asked to do. I mean,
so he gave you good direction.
Well, no, if you're asked to play a villain, you got to play a villain. You know, you can't play Elliot Ness if you're cast as Al Capone.
Thank you. Yeah, I feel like I'm at home right now. You know,
I bet in a couple of years this is going to be one of the most important film fests here in the United States. Thank you.
Almost a movie set is the only place, only workplace I think you can go to, probably except for professional sports, where everybody wants to be there.
White Knight. I'm Olga Segura, and I'm loving Twin Cities Film Festival. You gotta check it out.
Now, I worked at the post office. Nobody wanted to be at the post office. Whenever I got there, nobody didn't get that feeling. So it's just great.
Awesome, man.
You ever notice how everything good out there is white?
Uh-huh.
You got Whitey Ford. You got white bread. You got Snow White.
Vote low, vote white.
Leroy Lowe, Grand Dragon of the East Texas chapter of the Ku Klux Klan.
I don't have a problem with nobody, Warden. I ain't any colored. I'm pro-American.
Two counts of fraud, one count of federal fraud.
Sentenced to 3 years. You Klan folks ain't nothing but a hate-mongering bunch of troublemakers. So I'm fixing to pair you up with a new cellmate.
Who the hell are you?
My name is Emilio Ortiz.
Guard, get back here! You left a Mexican in my cell!
You have got to learn to get along amicably with your fellow prisoners. Do I make myself clear?
Oh, absolutely, Warden. Just think of this as the Rio Grande, a lowly state prison. On this side, we have the United States of America. On that side, we have Mexico. I don't go to Mexico. And you don't come to America.
There is a problem.
What problem?
America has the toilet.
Oh.
How about this place shining like a new pair of boots? You hear me?
Who's she?
You mean the maid?
There is something special about that one.
A woman wrote to you a letter? Oh, you're a very lucky man. What does woman say?
I don't know. I don't speak Spanish.
I do.
She's smart. She's kind. Unpretentious, and she's a hell of a hard worker.
People can change if they want, Mr. Lowe. But only if they really want.
Important film fest here in the United States.
Now tell us a little bit about your film.
Sold out tonight.
Yeah, no, it's been great. It's been a great experience.
It's been a wonderful experience, and just sharing the movie with audiences has been really special.
I feel like I'm at home right now. You know, it's just a great feeling. I love movies, and I've always loved movies.
You know, these stories are just so powerful that you guys are bringing together and sharing with an audience. If somebody wanted to come, you know, check out this film festival, how would they even figure out where it is and what to go see?
Sure.
Well, I think the best way to do that is visit the website. That houses 99.9% of our information. That's TwinCitiesFilmFest.org. That's where you can become a member. You can sign up for a newsletter. You can submit your film, which we always want you to do. You know, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. At any given time, give us a submission. Check out the Icon Theaters in St. Louis Park. We're planning on probably forming a long partnership with them. So we're going to have materials continually there for you to take. There'll probably be ongoing screenings. We're a year-round event, so don't look at it as just happening September. We're here to support film, and if it can fit into our programming in September, great. If not, we're always here for you to support.
Absolutely. And again, social networking as well. So if you go on our website, there's an opportunity to obviously follow us on Facebook or Twitter. So those are great avenues as well to keep updated on what's happening with the festival.
Well, I wanted to thank you guys for coming in today and sharing a little bit about the history, the story of how this festival gets to come together and the great films that you're choosing. I just think it's important because what you're doing is you're also helping to build the film community here. I mean, you're building the audience as well as helping to develop the filmmakers, which is it was a delicate tightrope to walk, but I think you're doing a really good job. So thank you very much.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you for watching this episode of Butter City. It's all about filmmaking with a Minnesota twist. So please check us out at our website at buttercity.com. We're on Facebook, and we tweet too. Thank you very much.